Hi everyone, I hope you can all hear me and I hope you can all understand my Scottish accent. It's hard times for everybody and we're going to talk about some of my experiences today. I'm a double amputee, you can't see. I would lift my legs up and show you but it would all get a bit weird, but I'm a double amputee and I'm an ex-soldier. I'm now a Paralympic athlete. And I'm just going to tell some of my story and maybe some of my experiences on how I dealt with change, how I dealt with stress and anxiety and the isolation that we're all going through at the moment, and how I dealt with that and how I came through it. Now we can push on and we can all maybe get through this sort of terrible experience that we're dealing with at the moment. Whatever you can take from it, take from it. I'm open to as many questions at the end. And hopefully, as a team, we can all maybe come up with some ideas at the end where we can both push each other forward. I'm in isolation as well, just like you are, and I'm hoping and praying that nothing happens to me or my family and we get through this all right, but we just have to see how it goes. I suppose the first thing I should do is take everything back to the beginning on why I'm talking to you this morning, and hopefully you'll be able to get an understanding of what I went through. I think we'll play the first video.
2001, 9/11 happened, and that changed everything for everybody in the army. I flew into Afghanistan for the very first time on New Year's Eve, and you certainly knew that we weren't going to be leaving there for a while. We'd be going out on foot patrol and trying to find and destroy the IEDs. 90% of the guys on the ground in Afghanistan were trying to keep away from these things, but we were trying to find them. We all knew someone that had been blown up, and we all knew someone that had died. It was a normal day. We had about 100 metres to clear. And then I stood on a pressure plate IED. Once the dust settled, I had loads of stuff in my eyes. And then I opened my eyes. I seen immediately that my left leg was gone. But I still tried to look for it. Because you don't think that it should just be gone. The initial blast feels like you fell down a hole and someone's hit you over the head with a sledgehammer. I could hear the Chinook coming because it's got a very distinctive double rotor. I could hear that coming and I knew it must be for me. And that was it. I was flying back to the UK. I was in a coma for 6 days. They had surgically amputated my right leg and my left leg was blast amputated. Even though I know my left leg wasn't there, it's like I still had to look to check, just in case I had imagined it. I think slowly you just start in your head thinking, how am I now going to do stuff? The up and down or the roller coaster of getting injured, you're just having so many operations that it can really set you back mentally. And then you realise that, alright, things are bad, but they're not as bad as they could be, but things have definitely changed. I used to do powerlifting for the army. I couldn't work out how I could do powerlifting again because I had no legs. They were doing a Paralympic potential day. From that initial day, it's like I decided that I was going to do it. The first time I got spotted was at a Sports Scotland Talent ID weekend, supported by the National Lottery. And then I seen what they were bench pressing, which was blowing my mind. So in my head I thought, just get on with my life. You gotta get training, son.
The videos will get cheesier as we go along. But I done that one for the National Lottery. And it just shows you maybe what I went through. I was a soldier and my background was in demolition, so I used to try and find things that blew people up and hopefully not get injured myself. But as you can imagine, it was a really dangerous job and there was quite a high percentage of us doing that job who unfortunately did get injured. And not only me, but a lot of my friends are double amputees because of that. But from the second the explosion went off, my job and my social group and my future had changed immediately. I didn't ever go back and wear uniform again. All I'd done was my rehab and had operations and surgeries, etc. So I was taking out my job role that I had done since I was 16. I was taking out my social group. I was put in a hospital to obviously try and save my life and make me better. But just thinking about what maybe people are going through at the moment, I had some really dark times, struggling to sleep, couldn't see where my future was, even worrying about financially how I might be able to get through this, because I'd only ever wanted to be a soldier, and now that was taken away from me. And I now knew that I had to not only learn to walk again, I had to try and make sure that I was going to be able to financially support my family. And it was as stressful as you can imagine. But also what's important is, I know that everybody's having a real bad time at the moment. Don't think that we can't relate that to what happened to me. Whatever keeps you up at night, keeps you up at night. We shouldn't try and measure how a person should be stressed and how they should react to certain situations. Me getting blown up can be just as stressful and put as much anxiety and pressure on you as you having the risk of losing your job and everything that comes with that. So it's like we're all in this together, and I felt the pressure of definitely getting myself back on the straight and narrow. And one of the best things I used to get through it is I used to set myself tiny little goals. My first one is I had to walk again. It was obvious. A lot of my friends were spinal injuries and they didn't have the chance to walk again. I was a double amputee. I could walk, and I certainly needed to push myself to achieve that. I got put into the place called Headley Court, which is the main rehab centre in Surrey, where all the injured soldiers went. And when I talk about times that we're going through at the moment, and hopefully you've got your team or your management or your group of friends or family, if you're struggling at the moment, we need to make sure that we surround ourselves with these positive people. Because the second I went to Headley Court, in my mind, I was a double amputee. I might be in a wheelchair. I was going to struggle to walk. But the second I got there, there was no question I was going to walk again. It was just when I was going to walk again. They had seen 10, 20, 30, 40 double amputees, and everybody walks. My physio told me it wasn't a question if I walked, it was when and how far and how quickly I'd done it. So the choice of failing, if we were going to class staying in a wheelchair as failing at that moment, was never an option. It was always when you were going to walk. And that was only because I had positive people there, and the staff and the friends that I had around me at that time. Everybody felt that they were going to push forward with me and help me to walk, encourage me to walk, encourage me to be the guy I was before. And I definitely felt that, because I was in so much stress. Like, it was difficult for me to sleep at night because of the worry. And you can maybe try and put yourself in that position now. You might be struggling to sleep at night. One thing I certainly didn't need is a negative person around me at that point. I didn't need someone to say, we might not get through this. Your job might not be there after the lockdown. Or Micky, you might have to stay in a wheelchair because I don't think you'd walk. Certainly, I didn't have that. And if I did think that that was there, we need to get rid of them at these moments of stress. I'm not saying that you should ditch everybody that isn't super positive, but just put them to the side a little bit, because we don't need to be dragging this anchor through all these hard times. And I felt that back then. But I soon found myself walking, and I worked hard, and I worked with the physios, and we got walking, and we were trying to get our lives back. But I was always very sporty, and I was always really strong, and I had quite a love for strength sport. And I seen what was happening after the London Paralympics, and I wanted to get involved in that movement. I wanted to be a Paralympian, but I just didn't know how to do it. I was trying all these different sports like archery or whatever, wheelchair this, wheelchair netball, whatever, and it just wasn't for me. I needed to lift some weights. I've always been the guy who could lift a heavy weight for no reason, but maybe not be as skillful at other things. It's just how I sort of was. So I found that we could take on Paralympic powerlifter. It was just a bench press. And you know what? It changed my view on stuff. I didn't need to worry meeting with the doctor or how much medication I might be on. I could concentrate on sport. But I still needed this team. People are going to be sat at home at the moment. And it can be lonely. And I don't know if you're keeping good like chats or WhatsApp groups or Zoom groups. But I needed to make sure that I had a good team around me. But again, we've got to be positive. Everybody was dealing with everything that was going on. Double amputees, triple amputees, people who had been shot in the head. And we needed to find this leader who could bring us out of it. We had every celebrity, every Z-list celebrity come and visit us, get the picture taken, and then put it in the paper and say they were going to support us. But no one did, because maybe we were struggling to walk too much, or a lot of us thought we had severe PTSD that would stop us being employable by their company. But we needed a leader, and maybe you need leaders now. Or if you are that management role or that leader role, maybe you should be pushing to ensure that your employees or the guys further down than you are supported. And we got that with Prince Harry. He decided to come and start up what was called the Invictus Games. No one knew what it was at the start. It was going to be a sporting event for any injured soldiers in the world could enter it. There's teams from Britain, America, Poland, France, anywhere you can think of. And he said that not only are we going to push you forward on a sporting level, but we're also going to push you forward to give you that positive and that inspiration to try and get employed. And tell the employers that the reason they should employ you is because what's happened to you. So if you have struggled mentally, if you've had to learn to walk, if you've had to deal with losing your job, your house and your friends, don't hold that against us. That should be the reason that you are employing us, because one thing we knew is we could get over some hard times. These challenges about learning to walk again or whatever, we can achieve them. We can bring positivity to your company. We can hopefully make your company push forward. And he said that, and he put his name on the tin, and he didn't need to. But we found that leader. We found that person that was willing to back us. And I hope that in these times that you're in at the moment, where it's tough, that you are getting the phone calls from your boss. Or if you are the boss, you are making the phone calls to the other guys and saying, you know what, we're going to get through this as a team. This is tough. It's hard. But we're going to support each other. And we're going to try and do the best we can do. The Invictus Games changed my life in London. And I then went to Orlando and we'd done the American Invictus Games. And I decided after that I was going to just concentrate on other stuff. I wanted to give the opportunity for the next guys to come in. Let them change their life. Let them have the same positive impact that had happened to me. So I decided after the Orlando Invictus Games that would be it. It was going to go out on the big American stage. And as per normal, I made a cheesy video to try and finish off that day.
I joined the army when I was 17. It was the only job I ever had. I was a fully committed soldier and I would have done my full time. You're working hard and playing hard, and it's something I still really miss to this day. One of our roles in Afghanistan was to find the IEDs that was blowing up the guys. It was a dangerous job. Most of the lads over there are keeping away for these things, and it's our job to go and find them. It was red hot, as it always was in Afghanistan in the summer, and we were on a patrol, and I stood on a pressure plate IED. I felt the whole impact go straight through my feet and then out my head, and I knew that I was in a bad way. Before I opened my eyes, I was just praying that there was going to be some sort of legs or feet there. And then I looked down and see my left leg was gone. And visually, my right leg was more harrowing than my left. It was smashed up as many places as a leg could be smashed up. I knew I was in big trouble from bleeding. I had three major wounds that were just bleeding out, and I could see the ground just changing colour in front of me. I really try hard to never think about it, but it's definitely a picture that I'm never going to forget. There's no doubt that things change and you look down in the hospital bed and you see your legs are gone. I never went unconscious throughout the whole thing, so I knew my legs were gone. I didn't even look under the duvet. Sport does give you a reason to get up out of bed. And doing powerlifting started giving me a bit of sense of getting Micky Yule back, getting back to the guy I was. And from the very start, I wasn't thinking about Invictus Games, but I was thinking just get a little bit stronger because you're on medication and you might be eating rubbish. And sport can change that, and it certainly did for me in the early stages. With the Invictus Games, it's all around building lives and getting back off dark places, PTSD or amputations. But it's also about competing and competing hard. And I go there to win. We annihilated the Americans last time. And they went back and they've been licking their wounds and training hard to make sure that we don't do that in their own backyard. But guess what? They're not going to get any medals through powerlifting. No for me anyway.
Said they are getting cheesier every time, but luckily I won that, or I would have looked really embarrassed if I hadn't won. But that was my end of my journey with the Invictus Games. I felt like I went into the Invictus Games learning to walk and learning to accept that I was disabled and maybe my future wasn't going to go down that path I wanted and I was going to go somewhere else. And I finished off in Orlando winning the gold medal, and it was a brilliant event. And it was time to move on. I wanted to commit fully to elite level sport. I wanted to go to the Paralympics and these big Commonwealth Games and represent my country on the real top stage. So it was a decision that I had to make to leave the Invictus Games behind. And then speak to my team about just how we could achieve this. Was it possible? Real Paralympics were coming up. This is stuff I had watched on TV, and could I see myself lifting there? Did I have the ability? Was I strong enough, both mentally and physically? And luckily, again, I had this team around me that we all believed in the process and we all pushed each other forward. Again, when I talk about negativity within the group, and can sometimes result in failure if you've got someone dragging you behind. So again, I got that tight circle and we pushed forward and I qualified for the Rio Paralympics, which was something that I'd never ever thought of when I was laying in hospital wondering how I was ever going to walk again, or maybe wondering if I could be the same father I was before the accident, or the same son, or the same person. And I felt that going to Rio Paralympics certainly showed there a big sort of end of a chapter in my book to go, right, this is where our life is at the moment, and now we can progress. And it took that time to get there. Again, there might be a lot of questions getting asked at home by yourselves or other people, like where am I? Where is my future? Is my company going to get through this? Am I still going to have a job at the end of this lockdown or this possible recession that's coming? It's big questions that everybody's asking themselves, but please don't have the confidence to push forward. And if you have to make these big calls, then maybe this is the ideal opportunity to make them. No one always has to be positive. It's something I always say. Throughout this whole process, I am not motivated the whole time. I have terrible days, especially at the start. I just felt like crap. I couldn't achieve nothing. I could never get anything done that I wanted. And you just got to take these days. There's not many people that hit all their targets every day and be the super positive person and just gets everything they want first time. And that's not realistic. Certainly not realistic at the moment. And it wasn't for me, even learning to walk, compete in sport, try and go to Paralympics. I had some crap days. And we got to take them. Listen, that's just life. It's just taking the bad days, accepting them, and just making sure the next day might not be as worse or as bad as the one before it, and trying to move on. As you can see, I've got a face for radio and I've got a terrible voice. But I decided I was going to try and take part in a challenge-based TV show. It was going to be a show where a disabled athlete was going to go up against an able-bodied athlete. and we were going to try and change just how we're boxed off as disabled people. I had been told that it wasn't possible for me to do this sport. I shouldn't do it. I'd get injured. I'd probably just mess it up. I had never done TV before. I had to go for a casting, a three-day casting for it. It was terrible. I felt so unconfident. I felt shocking. But I decided to go for it. It was once in a lifetime opportunity. And I decided that this is the time to try and step out of my comfort zone and push forward with some TV stuff. And this is the first video.
I was a Royal Engineer for 18 years. And in 2010, I found myself on my way to Afghanistan. I was walking down a patrol and I activated a pressure pad IED with my left foot. Just instantaneous, knew I'd been blown up. Pain, for 20 seconds, nothing. And then it's like a train coming. So I looked down, left leg gone. You sort of look for it, but it's not there. And then the right leg just as smashed up as you could imagine. Like someone just had been through a mincer. You think, well, not the best day I've ever had. I'm in the here. And that was the last thing I remember. I woke up about 8 days later from a coma in Birmingham. No legs, arms all bandaged up. Just open your eyes looking like that. Nothing else can move. Held together in a cage. You're sort of looking at your wife going, I'm all right. And they're looking at you saying, you're not all right. It wasn't supposed to end like that for me. I've always been a warrior. So that's when I started watching sport. The Olympics, the Paralympics, inspired me to become a Paralympic powerlifter. Could say that the Olympics saved my life. There is nothing like it. It's the best battling against the best. Champions.
The Olympics are the pinnacle of human sporting achievement. There's no bigger test of human endeavor than the Olympics.
But my favorite is the Winter Games. I mean, no one's gonna die running the 100 meters. But these guys on the snow and the ice, they risk their lives every single run. And the sport which always looked like the most dangerous and the fastest, to me, was always the skeleton. Sliding downhill, your face scraping against the ice at 120 kilometers an hour. You never feel more alive than when you're staring death in the face. Trust me, I know. People don't look at me and say Olympian. They look at me and think disabled. Right now, double amputees like myself can't even take part in skeleton sport. They say you need your legs to run, to jump, and to steer, and that I'm completely the wrong shape. But I want to prove that being an Olympian is not about having the perfect body or the perfect number of limbs. It's about the Olympic spirit. It's giving everything you've got and never giving up. So I am going to become a skeleton athlete, and then I'm going to go up against the best there is, the reigning, able-bodied world champion. And I am going to try and beat him.
And I actually feel I've not been as scared since then I was in Afghanistan than was when I was doing skeleton racing, because I was so untrained. It was so fast. The pain on my body was just, I kept on knocking myself out. I was hurting my shoulders, my elbows. I felt like I'd broke my hand, but you just kept on doing it. And that's why I got so much respect for these winter athletes, where the sport they do, that you can really, really hurt yourself. It's not like running. You're not going to pull a hamstring if it goes wrong in skeleton. You're going to end up in hospital with multiple breaks. And I've got a real, real respect for that sport, just doing that show. It was unbelievable. And before I knew it, I found myself in this big race in a place called Whistler in Canada, which is like the most beautiful place you've ever seen. It's like a big Scotland. It's like Canada, big waterfalls, beautiful snow, and it's the fastest track in the world. I had only done 8 training runs. I'd done a few in Austria, and then they sent me over there to race the 5 times world champion. Throughout this whole process, They were trying to work out how fast they could throw me down the track, and we couldn't work it out. And when I went to Canada, they decided to attach two rockets to my legs that had the same power as two like mini motorbikes, and it would throw me down the hill as fast as it could. But let's see if I compete or die in the next video.
Micky Yule is the first double amputee to take on the skeleton. He took on powerlifting after losing both his legs to an IED, going on to become the first Brit to win an Invictus Games gold medal in 2016.
I mean, this is no joke. If it goes wrong, it goes wrong in a very big way.
Then Micky teamed up with experts to take on the fastest track in the world. His hard work paid off.
Winter Thunderbird on the left-hand side. That is the perfect line. Brilliant.
Face first and hurtling at speeds of more than 100 miles per hour, Micky's win was shown in a film documenting his journey.
31.8.
He doesn't just overcome obstacles, he leaves them in the dust.
And he was a Russian guy, and he was really, really, really pissed off that I beat him. But there was no banter from him. He didn't really like that, and he didn't like the fact that I used rockets at the start, which was a bit unfair. I appreciate it, but he's 5 times world champion. Do you know what I mean? He should have beat me. But it's just shown you, I never ever thought I would do that. To me, I'm still a soldier in my head. I would join the army again tomorrow. But what happened to me changed it all, and it was unplanned. But I have made sure that I'm trying to grab every little opportunity I can on the way, even when I think I can't achieve it, or maybe the job's too big for me. I've decided that I should always try and take it on, and then the worst thing that will happen maybe is I don't achieve it, or we have to start again and look at somewhere else. But that was the sort of pinnacle of me taking a risk. I decided after that I would never do skeleton again, because it was too dangerous and I kept on breaking my bones. But it just showed maybe what, when you're thinking about where you can go, we can maybe try some big risks, and we can maybe look at going in a different direction, and you just never sort of know where it will take you. But I understand that we're all quite maybe stuck in the houses and we're wondering where this is all gonna go. But if we just try and stay positive as best we can, even though it's hard, try and keep these Zooms and these WhatsApp groups going and stay with your friends. This is going to be very hard to get through on our own. Like, I couldn't have walked on my own. I couldn't do it. Didn't matter how much motivation I would have had, I could not have walked on my own. I needed a physio, I needed surgeons, I needed doctors, I needed people who made the legs, the prosthetists. I couldn't have done it on my own. And I feel that where we are at the moment, if there's big pressure on your job or financially or within the home life, we need to just really lean on our friends or our family or whatever our support group is. This is a time that we need to lean on them. Just finishing off, I would say that wherever you find yourself at the moment, please just try and approach your friends or whoever that go-to person is, or the group that's going to really keep you positive. This is a time that we need to speak to them and we need to lean on them. And it's certainly what I'm doing as well. This is tough for everybody. And if you can take anything from what I've been through with getting blown up, learning to walk, deciding to try and take on Paralympic sport and these different level of sort of risks, then hopefully it'll push you in the right direction, because it's not easy. Some crap days, but you know what? We're going to get through it. And if we stay positive, it's going to help us get through it in a better situation at the end.
Oh, Micky, thank you so much.
Thanks.
I always love chatting to you. You've been through so much, and you've obviously taken a lot of time to consider your journey and everything that's happened to you, and I always find it really inspiring to be in your company. So thank you for sharing that with everyone today. Obviously, we're all going through a huge amount of change at the moment with COVID-19. How has that affected your Paralympic campaign? Because obviously the Paralympics is now being postponed. What and how are you dealing with that?
Yeah, so the Olympics and then the Paralympics have just been postponed, I think, 2 or 3 weeks ago. And it's really tough, but as it's tough for everyone. I train at Loughborough University, and I've been at home training now for 5 weeks. But as we know, the kids' schools got closed, so I'm trying to do the kids and any sort of schooling that might come out ahead. And then I've got to train, and I've got to make sure I don't get fat. I've got to keep my diet as tight as I can. But it's tough, and it was a decision that had to be made because no one could train. And actually, we see in America, it's got even worse, and it's drifting down to Africa. So I was quite happy when they made the decision. I was dreading trying to go to the Paralympics from training on my garage on my own with no support. I just felt that if we're going to go to the highest level of sport, then we should have the highest level of training to achieve that target. And me training in the garage with my 4-year-old daughter running in and out wasn't going to do that. So I was relieved when they delayed it. I did spend 4 years trying to qualify for it, which is frustrating, but I'll get through this, and then I'll regroup with the team, and then we'll go again, because if anything, the qualification will be even tougher, and getting selected to go to Tokyo will be even harder again, because each year everybody's getting stronger. So the challenge is still just try and stay strong in the mind, and then push forward again.
What do you feed your what do you do to feed your mind to keep strong and positive? Books, podcasts, music, etc.?
Your music, podcast, definitely. I work very closely with our sports psychologist in Loughborough, and probably something years ago that I would have thought that I wouldn't need, and maybe would have looked down on, but I think as I get older and wiser, the more I appreciate being mentally strong and just actually having someone to speak to. A lot of the time we don't speak about sport, but he's there to change that around to how I'll then get stronger and perform better. But I do seem to go and vent and try and get all my problems out, and I just speak more. I used to hold a lot of stuff in, and I used to have this mindset that I will take care of everything. And maybe it's a bit weakness trying to share your problems with other people, but I wouldn't share it with anybody who I thought it might put any more stress or anxiety on them. But just sharing your what's going on, and just actually getting strong in the mind by realizing that everybody's generally going through a hard time, and then everybody's trying to achieve different stuff. But I will always train hard, and I'll always be strong, and my coaches will ensure that I train hard, and they'll ensure that I am training as hard as I can full time. But actually what they can't see is what's in between your ears, and that's probably the most critical part when it comes to competing at a high level. I think the winners and losers are normally what happens the 24 hours before you compete, and just what's going on in your head. And I'm getting better at that. Still, I don't think we ever stop that journey, but I do rely on speaking to my sports psychologist quite a lot, especially on the build-up to big comps where the stress levels are going through the roof. The chances of being injured are increased because of the training's increased. And I don't know if anybody's ever had to make weight, but powerlifting is like boxing. You want to be the biggest guy in your weight category, which means that you have to bring that weight down, and you get grumpy, you're starving, just, you can imagine that all the stresses are there, and you're starving hungry because you want to eat, and you can get cranky, but you need that support around you to go, do you know what, we'll get through this together.
Do you find that the current isolation situation is similar to a lot of your challenges, in that there's a beginning and there will be an end, but it's maybe how you deal with the bit in between that really measures you and I guess kind of makes the person that you are.
Yeah, I think definitely. A performance director is just dropping little messages and little sort of reminders that during this period, if we can do 1% more than what our competition is doing at home, this is a real chance to get a catch on them and to really get a gain on them without really trying too hard. So I'm sat at home. I know that the qualification is going to start again. Now, in between this, it's really hard with kids and just maybe financial stuff and how we're all going to get through this. And I'm not saying be positive the whole time. And I'm not saying that you should let's work on our personal development on this isolation, because you know what? If you've got kids, you can't. If you've got kids running around, it's tough. And actually, the best thing you'll do that day is just get those kids back to bed and happy. And then you might sit down and have a little drink. And we're just taking this little time now to maybe just settle and but just don't keep an eye on what's coming at the end of it. I think if everybody switches off now and just waits for the end of the lockdown, then people are going to have the catch on us. I think we just have to keep on ticking and making sure that everybody is where they are. But don't let yourself slip off the hill too much, because you just pay for it once done.
How do you deal with anger, and can it be a positive thing? Because I think in this situation with COVID-19, there is a lot of sort of outward anger towards, you know, towards everything that's happening. It's unfair and it's unjust. And although there's lots of empathy and sympathy with, you know, those that are losing their lives and the incredible work that the NHS workers are doing, people, I think, also think, but what about me and my life? And, you know, if I've got a family to feed and I can't do that, there's that sort of internal anger there. So is that something that you've experienced, and how do you deal with it, and can it be a positive thing?
So many different ways to look at this. Like, we've got everybody, you must stay in and no one go out because you're going to spread the disease. And I'm watching these news conferences and seeing the economy's going this way, everybody's stress levels are going that way. And I'm just, I try and stay as best as I can not get angry. But this is a strange time, because before I do big lifts, I like to be angry, because I feel like I need to perform better under that bar with a little bit of fire in my belly and a little bit of anger. But then when you come in the house, because my garage is just there, you can't see it, that's where my gym is. And I sometimes like to go in there a bit angry to through music and perform well. And then I come in and you look at the TV and you look at everything else and you can't go out. And I feel that I have to bring anger into that performance sort of arena, but then really switch off when I come in, because you could just lose your mind at the moment. And I don't think it's such a bad thing that people can just admit that, but it's just tough, man. No one's ever dealt. My son's 13 and he asked me how often this happens. He goes, Dad, does this happen like every 20 years? And I went, no, this never happens. Nobody knows what they're doing. Because he thought, well, maybe this is just what happens every so often and we just all have to deal with it. But I was trying to explain to him that this is tough. I think I said to you yesterday that when I went to the Rio Paralympics, I took myself off Facebook, because I just didn't need that in my life, because I had so many experts telling me how to get strong and experts telling me how to diet and how I should change my coach and change what I'm doing in training. And I took myself off Facebook because I felt that social media pressure was just adding to everything else. And I do tend to find that in these stressful times that I'll probably be on social media less, because I don't want to hear the experts on there that live two doors up the road trying to tell me why the chief medical officer's wrong. So it's tough, man. I'm trying not to get angry. I quite like being angry in the gym, but I'm trying to stay as level-headed as I can.
You're saying that if you harness anger and you use it the right way, it can be a positive thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially when you're lifting, trying to bench press 200 kilos.
Yeah.
I can't go in there just, I need to be Do you know what I mean?
That's going to be one of my questions, is what weight are you lifting? Because, I mean, there's lots of colours, lots of weights on that bench press that you're doing. But how?
Well, so my personal bench is best is 195 kilos. I was probably weighed 70 kilos for that. So brought my weight down and kept the power. But 200 kilos is what I need to lift to be as successful as I want to be in Tokyo. It's a fair old lift, like it's a big old lump of a lift. It's certainly not what I want to do in the garage on my own. I think I'll need a bit of support for that one. There's a reason. This is every 4 years, and it probably takes me 2 seconds a lift, and I get 3 lifts to win a medal. So I've trained 4 years for 6 seconds, and that's why I talk about mentally, because people mess up at the Paralympics more than it. You ain't going to mess up at the British because you're a bit more comfortable in your surroundings and you sort of know it's every year. If it's 6 seconds every 4 years, the pressure comes and you need to stay strong mentally because you ain't going to get any stronger, but your head will talk you out the lift. So that's why I work so hard on the mental side. But yeah, 6 seconds to change your whole life.
Interested to know, where did you get your inspiration from? Were you a World's Strongest Man fan as a child?
I think everybody was. Christmas, World's Strongest Man was on TV, wasn't it? I used to watch that with my dad, but I've always been strong. I used to enjoy, before I was injured, just for years, going to the gym with my friends. It's maybe that bro thing, but it's one thing I do miss, that sort of training with that big group in the gym. But I've naturally always been strong, and it wasn't until I got injured and started having specific coaching that I just knew exactly how strong I could be. But you know what, I like it. It keeps me out of trouble. It gives me a focus. It's just, you know, I've got a passion for it. Even when I stop trying to compete at the Paralympic level, I'll probably always train.
Yeah. So I think we've got a couple of minutes left. Obviously, yeah. Paralympics is your next challenge. Have you, and you're obviously focused on your 6 seconds and hopefully winning the gold. Have you thought beyond the Paralympics and what's next and what your next challenge after that would be?
Well, I think we always have to keep in the back of our heads what we're going to do after sport, but I do want to give back. I do love coaching. I want to find this 18-year-old guy who might have just been newly disabled and is worrying how he's going to get through it, and I'd love to just mentor and coach him. I want a big old lump of a guy, and I can just bring him through, train him, and just get him to bench press about 250 kilos. That's what I would love. But I think I can give a lot back. I've got a lot of experiences and just dealing with crap, basically. But I think I'd like to keep the coaching going. It's something that I'm passionate about. And I think that would be it. The Commonwealth Games are in Birmingham in 2022. And I always thought that I would stop after Tokyo. But now they've extended or postponed Tokyo, it brings it really close to the Birmingham Commonwealth Games, which is basically a home games. Like the last one was Glasgow and then we went to Australia. But I think it would be very hard for me not to go to Birmingham. I do admit that.
Yeah. Well, it would be lovely to kind of, if that was your final hurrah, to go out on home soil. I think everybody really felt how incredible the atmosphere and how wonderful it was that the nation came together with the 2012 Olympics when they were in London. And how special that was. And I think all the athletes, you could say, when you certainly listen to their stories afterwards, they talk, yeah. You know, that it was just everything was on another level for them. So I can actually quite understand that. And I personally, you know, I've chatted to you a few times now, and I think you'd be a great coach. You are, you know, you're an incredibly kind man. And even though lots of your photographs, you look quite terrifying when you're sort of pulling these faces, bench pressing. You're sort of a big softie at heart, and I think, you know, as a coach, you're driven, but you're very kind of kind and honest with it as well. So I think that would be a great career for you.
And Thanks. I love that. Yeah. Do you know the Commonwealth Games? I've came fourth twice, and it is driving me mad. I've done my three lifts and been in the medal position, and then I've watched people come out and then lift a weight that has pushed me out the medal zone. And it's just crazy. Frustrating. And I've had the camera in my face waiting on me to celebrate a medal, and this is just life. The minute they see the thing, the other guy lift more than you, the camera moves, you go one way, the medals go the other.
That must be heartbreaking. How do you deal with that when you've focused? I know we're wrapping up, but it's quite interesting. But how do you deal with that when you focus for 4 years on that time, and then you just literally see it taken away, and you have no more lifts. You can't lift another thing. You just see it disappear.
Yeah, it is frustrating. I don't mind if they lift more than me. So, you know, if on the day if someone just lifts more than you, then I'm pretty happy with that. Twice, Glasgow and the Gold Coast Commonwealth Games, this big Indian guy has beat me on those last lifts. But do you know what? The guy's all right. It's frustrating. I wish I hated him a bit more. But if you lift the lift, then you deserve it. And if I lifted more than him, then I would deserve it. And you just got to train harder. That's it. But it drives you mad for about 6 months.
Do you think that there are sort of similarities in terms of if you keep that focus, that dedication, that commitment, that drive, that you are almost a kind of an author, you write your own story?
Yeah, no. Listen, what we do, whenever we open our eyes in the morning, we've got decisions where we're going to go that day, unless your kids are deciding it for you. But, you know, I feel like I've been there so many times on this roller coaster of operations, blown up, walking. Like, I've never, one thing I always say to people, I've never succeeded to where I want. I've not got there. I've not won a Paralympic medal. I've not won a Commonwealth Games medal. That's what I want. That's what I need to get to. So wherever I go, some people can go, well, you're in hospital with no legs and now you're going here. But that's them setting their own achievements. That's them setting their what they're classing as success. It's not success for me. I've got to come back with a medal. I feel like I've put too much into this sport to not keep on pushing for a medal. And I'm going to get there eventually, and I've not even worked out how I'll get there, but I'll just keep on training and training and training, stay injury free, and you know what, I'll be a lot closer than I would if I gave up. So I've just got to keep grinding. It's tough, man, but it's tough. Like, life's tough, isn't it? It's tough for everybody.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. Micky, thank you so much for all of your time today. There are lots of really lovely messages in the chat. Genevieve's saying you're a winner and we know that you'll get there. Caleb has just off the call. He said it was awesome and thank you for the motivation. Trace said Birmingham has your name on it. And lots of people agree that dropping off social media is probably a good thing right now. And staying positive is a good thing as well. And you're, what a man, your attitude, strength and perseverance are incredible. And then thanks a lot. Look forward to following your story, which is again, do you want to tell people where they can find you? Because you have got social media presence and a website as well. If people want to follow your...
Probably on Twitter or Instagram. My Twitter handle is Micky Yule 9. And Instagram, where I'll put normally most of my training, is embarrassingly Big Micky 9, and I need to change that. You can't be involved in strength sport if you don't put big before your name.
Micky, thank you very, very, very much for being on today. I know we said it was half an hour and we've taken an hour, so thank you everyone to giving up an hour of your day as well. It's really lovely that you've been able to join us. There are more motivation in isolation events coming up. So if you go and have a look at the Eventbrite page where you signed up for this one, or On the Zest Global Events website. There's a motivation in isolation page there. And there are more wonderful people like Micky who are also sharing their stories and really just trying to support everybody who is feeling isolated at home through a series of these free events. So please do let people know that they are happening, and we'd love to have as many people come and join and get a daily dose of inspiration from people like Micky. So thank you again, Micky Yule, and we will see you again. Thank you very much, everybody, for joining.
Bye.
Thanks. Goodbye.